Hi everyone, welcome back to the Scale Model Medic YouTube channel. In this video, I'm going to be experimenting with weathering powders to achieve some dry and damp mud effects on the running gear of this half track. Medic! So a while ago, I was on eModels looking for kits for future build videos, and I stumbled upon the Italeri Panzerwerfer. It's one of those vehicles that the Germans came up with where they just started sticking guns and rockets on anything that moved. So it's one of those interesting subjects where it would have had a bit of a longer service life, and so you could go a little bit wild with the weathering and it wouldn't look out of place. I bought the model. It's a 1998 Italeri kit, so I ran into trouble straight away. It's got the worst tracks that I've ever built, and there were some big gaps that needed some styrene with some extra thin to fill them. But considering I was right on the arse end of the model world budget, it's actually not that bad, and it built into a really nice little kit. It took some modelling skill to get it together in a few places, but if you are on the cheap end of the kit market, you can still pick up stuff which is fun to build, and this is one of those such kits. I immediately set about a very long and detailed video series on it, and after filming maybe 5 or 6 hours, I kind of had a massive moment of clarity where I realised I was investing a load of time in a video about a 1998 Italeri kit, and I kind of stopped myself and cancelled the project. But there was one portion of it which had really good responses on Facebook and people seemed interested, and that was the mud weathering on the lower hull. So I figured, seeing as I've got all the footage filmed already, I'll edit this together into a little tutorial on how I did the mud effects, so that if you're new to weathering or if you're looking for something to try a little bit different, you can have a go at what I did on this to try and get mud which doesn't just look dry, but it looks like it's also got some damp areas, and therefore it's adjusting the colour and it's all sort of different and looks a little bit more interesting than just plastering on one colour of mud and moving on. To get to the point where the weathering started, everything you see here is Mr. Hobby Aqueous thinned with Mr. Hobby Leveling Thinners. It was primed with UMP Grey Primer, and before I painted the dark yellow one, I did apply a sort of mottled coat of black just to experiment with that sort of aircraft modelling approach, even though you can't really see it once all the paint's gone on over the top. Once the camo was done, it was glossed, it was given a wash, and then I put a matte coat on to kill the shine. And I went in and I did an oil dot filter, which is something I've not done for over 10 years. But because the camouflage scheme was so bright and garish, it really needed this filter just to bring everything together and to fade the paint a little bit. I'm just using a few colours of oil paints, yellow, green, burnt umber and a little bit of buff. And once that dried, it did just sort of kill the stark contrast between the camo colours and the dark yellow. And then over the top of that, another quick mist of matte varnish allowed me to move on to the weathering stages. Now, I don't know why, but the lower hull is always the favourite part of the weathering for me. I think it's because you can do what you want down there. It's where the weathering's at its most extreme. And the best bit is you get to put the wheels and tracks on afterwards and hide all your mistakes. Another portion that I did enjoy was this really crude little exhaust, and I'll just give that a bit of chipping and weathering. No hairspray or anything like that, just a bit of sponge chipping and then some oils over the top. Before I got started with the weathering powders, I applied a coat of oil paint weathering to the sides of the lower hull using Abtalung 502 dark mud and burnt umber oil paints thinned with Humbrol's enamel thinners. The idea behind this was that I didn't know at the time just how heavy I wanted to go with the weathering powders. So if there was an area which I wanted to leave untreated with the mud effect, there would be a layer of weathering visible underneath and it wouldn't look like there was just a clean spot on the model. I built up the oil paints in the obvious places where dirt would accumulate, so in the recesses and the raised details. And then over the large flat sides, I just introduced some vertical streaking and I carried that weathering right the way up to where the fenders meet with the side of the vehicle, so that depending on how high I went with my mud effects, all of the areas would be covered. This is all pretty standard stuff and I do go into it in more depth in my series on the Meng King Tiger, so if you're interested in this portion you should go back and watch that video series first. A second coat of oils went on over the top just to darken everything off. And then to blend everything together and to break the surface up even more, I switched over to using highly thinned oil washes applied with the splattering technique. When these land on the surface, they appear quite stark and obvious, but because they're enamel thinners based, they do seep in and they work like dots of little tiny filters which go on and break up the surface and add a lot of visual interest. So I applied many layers of these before going back in with a brush moistened with enamel thinners and just cleaning off any spots that I didn't like the look of, just to tone down a few of the areas where maybe the splats were a little bit too big or they just didn't look natural. Once all those oil paints were dry, it was time to move on and start with the subject of this video and get into the bit where I add the mud. Sorry it took 5 minutes to get to this point. To fix the pigments to the surface of the model, I needed a fixer. Now, modern trends and my own recent videos all lean towards using enamel products, but in this video I went old school and I used Woodland Scenic Scenic Cement. Now bear with me, it's not an obvious choice, it's a bit of an old boys product from the railroad hobby side of things, but this is perfect for the job and it does genuinely dry to a perfectly matte finish. The main colour for the dried mud effect would be light sienna from Vallejo Pigments, and I decided to get started by priming the surface a little bit using ordinary tap water to dilute some of the scenic cement and create myself a bit of a pigment wash. This would help with a couple of things. First of all, it would start to shift the colour of the model towards the weathering powder that I'm using, which helped to blend everything together, but more practically, it starts to actually make the surface a little bit more porous. Bear in mind, I've applied a lot of oil paints to this surface. If I used just an acrylic varnish to try and hold the pigments, it would probably bead on the oils. The scenic cement, there's something in it which helps it to adhere, and you can see it's flowing straight over those oils with no beading at all. So it's almost like a pigment primer. Now the downside to using an acrylic like this is tide marks, because you can't go in and blend it with enamel thinners afterwards. So on any area where I didn't apply the wash to the whole surface, I had to go back in with a brush diluted with water alone and then just clean away any tide marks. And you can see I managed to keep the majority of the concentrations where I wanted them. Once that initial pigment wash was on, I locally applied some of the scenic cement and then started to actually physically pile the weathering powders in with the brush. I start by applying some of the scenic cement, or you could use the same wash mixture if you wanted to use that up. And then on top of that, just pile dry powder. And you'll see the scenic cement wicks into the weathering powders and it really does hold its volume well. It becomes physically three-dimensional and it starts to look like mud straight away. By doing this, repeating the applications, I was able to build up large concentrations of dried mud in a very short space of time. The downside, again, with it being acrylics, is that when it dries, it can look quite jarring and it doesn't blend in well to the area around it. To counter this, I simply used more of the pigment wash and applied it in localized areas to help blend the colors down together. And when it dried, it had a much more easy transition between the different colors. And that's really as simple as it is for the first step in this weathering process. Simply apply the fixer to the model and then pile the dry powders over the top to build up the impression of dried mud. Now, obviously, I want to take it a bit further than just using this initial texture. So I mixed up a thick paste of the light sienna weathering powder with the scenic cement, again diluting it just with a bit of water to help with flow. And then I applied this mixture to the model using the splattering technique. Using a really old brush and a scrap of card, I flicked the paste onto the underside of the vehicle and just allowed it to build up in these really tiny little speckles. Now, I already mentioned how well this stuff holds its physical volume when you're piling it in, but the same applies to when you're applying it with the splattering technique. It forms these little tiny spikes of weathering powder that cling to the model, and they give the impression of mud that's been flicked up by spinning wheels or tracks, and then dried while it's still standing proud of the surface. Now, usually you can achieve this with any different mixtures, but you have to add plaster or sand, and that shifts the colour slightly, whereas this is pure weathering powder, so it stays the same colour as that powder that we added in the initial layer. And here you can see after one application just how much texture that's added and how it's also helped to blend away any tide marks from that first application. Now, this is all looking very bland and monotone, so it was time to go a step further and start to experiment with some moisture. The first thing that I experimented with to try and replicate moisture was Citadel's Agrax Earthshade Wash. This is quite a rich brown acrylic wash, so I was hoping it would shift the tone of the weathering powders, make it much darker in these areas, and it would look like these parts of the model had stayed damp rather than being dry like the rest of the finish. However, after applying it in logical places and allowing it to dry, it had shifted the tone of the weathering powder quite nicely and made it look much more interesting and have a nice varied colour. It just didn't look like there was much moisture there, so it was time to move on to the next thing that I experimented with, which was MIG Ammo's Satin Varnish. Now, I know from the Meng King Tiger video that I did that using varnishes over the top of dry weathering powder can move the colour of it and make it look like that area is still damp. But in this occasion, it just didn't have the effect that I was hoping for, and it just hadn't hit the spot. I needed to go a step further, so the next thing I tried was Citadel's Null Oil Wash. This is a black acrylic wash, and I was hoping this would do the trick, but I would have to be on the lookout all the time for tide marks, because this is quite a stark colour to be applying over the top of finished weathering. I don't know whether it was the Null Oil Wash on its own, or whether it was working in conjunction with the Agrax Earthshade and Satin Varnish that I'd applied, but when this application dried, I was left with these areas with much better contrast and a much more interesting colour and variation in the tone, which did look like there was some moisture trapped in that dried mud layer. So overall, I was really happy with the way this part of the weathering had played out. Unfortunately, with the running gear in place, you can't really see it, but that's part and parcel for the hobby, and I know it's there, and anyone who goes looking for this detail will find that weathering under the running gear. Armed with the experience of that lower hull, I decided it was time to start weathering the wheels and tyres for the front and to move backwards towards the tracks. I kicked this off with another primer layer of the light sienna pigments mixed with the scenic cement. I concentrated this first around the treads where the obvious recesses would pick up the weathering powder, but I did give the front of the tyre another coat of the pigment wash to act as that primer that I mentioned before. This just makes the surface a bit more porous and helps future pigments to stick to that painted finish. Once that initial layer of powder had dried, I gave the tyre a bit more of a wash, just with a slightly more concentrated coat of the pigments to impart a little bit of colour and to start the weathering process off. This was allowed to dry fully, and then it was time to apply the really fresh mud around the outside of the wheel. I decided to switch to using Vallejo's natural umber pigments for this step, which are a much darker brown and would give me a head start on making this area look quite wet and have that moisture of freshly applied mud. After mixing up quite a stiff paste of the natural umber and the scenic cement, this was tapped onto the outside of the wheel in quite a haphazard fashion. In a few areas I left the tread exposed, as I wanted this to look like really fresh dirt just clinging onto the outside of the tyre. When it had dried, it was time to tie the fresh mud into the dry dust on the front of the wheel, and for this I used some MIG Ammo Satin Varnish, but to shift that colour and give the appearance of moisture, I mixed in some of the Citadel Null Oil, which had been effective for me on the lower hull, and I actually mixed that in with the satin varnish, so I was combining the colour change of the Null Oil with that little bit of a sheen from the satin varnish. This mixture I was hoping would bring that moisture through from the fresh mud and look like it was seeping into that dry dust on the front of the wheel. I applied the mixture of Null Oil and varnish using the side of the brush just to try and catch it in a few different areas and give it a patchy look, like that freshly applied mud was drying on the vehicle. To give the appearance of the moisture seeping into that dry dust on the front, I then had to bring that varnish layer down
onto the front of the tire. And again, I used the side of the brush for this as I wanted it to look quite natural and random. And I felt that using the tip of the brush might give the game away and you would actually be able to see where I'd painted this mixture on. By using the edge of the brush, I was able to just have that little bit of a random application, which looked a lot more natural. At this point, my confidence was starting to grow in the technique and I felt like it would give me the effect that I was looking for. So to accentuate the presence of that moisture, I brought the varnish layer right the way across the tyre and into contact with the rim of the wheel itself, where I fanned it out to look like the water was moving around the wheel through capillary action. This would just give the impression of water trickling down over the face of the tyre when the vehicle came to a halt, and it would just bring attention to the fact that that moisture effect was there. I decided that I needed to add a little bit more mud around the outside of the wheels to give all that moisture an obvious source, so I went back in with the natural umber pigments and the scenic cement and just built up that mud effect a little bit more, following the line of the varnish layer. And I also brought some of that weathering powder down onto the face of the wheels, just to continue that colour through towards the rest of the model piece. And also, if there's a lot of mud flying around, it's obviously going to land on the face of the wheels as well. To finish the job, I switched back to the light sienna weathering powders and I added some areas of dried mud right in the middle of the wheels, which is furthest from exposure to the moisture. And I also got the Agrax Earthshade washout again, just to vary the tone a little bit and also to reinstate some of the lost contrast around those raised areas where the weathering powder had obscured the washes from my initial weathering. Moving on to the running gear at the rear of the vehicle, I started again with that initial layer of weathering powder wash, just to get things started. And then I started to build up some of the light sienna weathering powders to give me that initial dried mud layer. I concentrated this on the outer facing road wheels, which were obviously more exposed to mud. And I also concentrated the effect on the outside perimeter of the wheel and then moved gradually towards the centre. Building up the texture with the brush, it was then obviously time to go ahead and start experimenting with the moisture content in that mud as well. And at this point, I'd been to the Telford model show and I'd picked up some pigments from the guys at Ultimate Modelling Products. One of the colours they do is Dirt, which is a really rich dark brown and was perfect for giving me that head start on having those darker areas in the weathering. To transition smoothly between the light sienna of the dry mud layer and the darker brown of the dirt pigments, I started by applying a highly diluted wash of the dirt powder using the scenic cement, and then I used a thicker paste with more of the powder to go back in and concentrate the darker colour around the outside of the road wheel. The transition and the interaction between the two colours was really good and it saved me a lot of time rather than messing around with washes and gave me a more consistent effect. So experimenting with this method had really paid off and I've got something to use on future builds for quick weathering. Another product that I picked up at Telford was this AK Interactive Splatter Effect Wet Mud, which was actually a pretty good colour match for the UMP dirt. And I splattered some of this on just to add some extra texture and to give some feeling of movement in that weathering as that mud was splattering onto the wheels. To get started with the tracks, I mixed up a really dark brown using Mr. Hobby Aqueous Flat Earth and Matte Black. I thinned it with Mr. Hobby Leveling Thinners and then I airbrushed this base coat over the entirety of the tracks. As with all the other weathering so far, my initial step was to mix up a pigment wash of the light sienna and the scenic cement, and then I applied this across the entirety of the track as well. The only area that I didn't treat with this pigment wash was the part between the guide horns on the inside face. I figured that the constant contact of the road wheels in this area would have largely kept any buildup of dirt at bay, so I just concentrated the pigment wash around the outside face of the tracks in this area. Once that initial layer of pigment was dry, it was time to start with the localised application of the scenic cement before piling in the weathering powders to build up that initial dried mud layer. This is a very time consuming way to weather tracks, but I prefer to be more deliberate when I'm doing this stage. Rather than plastering the whole track with a layer of weathering, I like to build up the effect in between the links. If you watched my video on the Meng King Tiger, I did it on there as well. And what it does is it allows me, first of all, to have more control over where the mud goes. So I can leave some areas free of mud as if the, you know, the dirt's fallen off while the track's in use. But it also allows me to keep the high spots of the track free from any weathering. These are typically polished shiny by contact with the earth. And if you've piled weathering powder on them, all you're really doing is painting metallic paint over the top of the weathering powder, and I don't think that looks as good as if you left those areas free to start with. So I moved very deliberately around the track using the weathering powders in a really localized fashion to apply the buildup of the dried mud. Once that initial dried mud layer was done, I switched back to using the natural umber pigments, which are the darker brown. And I started by mixing up quite a thin wash of that darker colour and then allowing that to sort of seep into the dried mud layer. To try and capture the look of mud drying in place on the tracks, I tried to work in as random a fashion as I could, and I didn't think about it too much. I just varied the concentration of the powder in the mixture and worked my way around the tracks in a really random fashion. I used quite a small brush to keep everything localized between the track links to keep those high spots free of any powder, and I just meandered my way around the tracks until I'd applied the effect all over. To transition as smoothly as possible between the two colors of weathering powder, I mixed up a really thin wash of the natural umber pigments with the scenic cement, and then I just applied this around the edges of the darker spots just to fade the colours together and to give the impression that the mud on the tracks was drying in place. When that was completed, I mixed up a wash of the UMP dirt pigments, which is the really dark brown, and using a small brush, I just picked out the edges of a few of the track links just to boost contrast in a few of the areas, mainly where the tracks bent around the drive sprockets, just to give it a bit more of a divided look between the track links. Here you can see the pigment layers all dried up, and the only thing left to do now is to pick out those high spots on the track with a bit of metallic to make it look like there's metal underneath showing through the weathering. The quickest and easiest way I've found to do this is to take an ordinary pencil and to just rub the side of the lead along the raised areas of the tracks. Once everything had been given a nice metallic sheen with the pencil, it was time to get the tracks in place to finish the running gear off. After negotiating everything into place, it was pretty obvious that this gap between the track and the road wheel needed to be fixed. It was about 5 millimeters, so it just couldn't be ignored. Because the gap was so big, I was able to easily get in there with a cocktail stick and some CA gel, and I put a blob of glue on top of all the road wheels before rolling up some tufts of kitchen roll and wedging them between the track and the fender. This pushed the tracks down into contact with the road wheels, and by repeating this 3 or 4 times, I was able to bend the track into the desired shape, and the CA glue held everything in place. And here you can see the end result of all that weathering. Watch in amazement as the moisture effect on the tyre disappears in the direct light from the lamp. It is still visible to the naked eye, and I am happy with the way that came out, so that's a technique that I will use again on future builds. But above all else, it was nice to go back to a budget kit and work on my skill set a little bit and try to develop some interesting tones and textures using a very limited palette of colours and quite a simple technique for application. If you're new to weathering, I hope this video has been useful to you and it'll give you some inspiration and ideas. I hope you've enjoyed watching the video, and I hope you'll consider hitting the like button, maybe giving me a subscribe and a share somewhere. So thanks very much for watching, and I'll see you again next time.